Well, good morning, everyone, at Emmanuel United Methodist Church, and here we are on this another snowy weekend, and I hope and pray that we're able to have church today. If not, we'll post this video on the United Methodist Church, First United Methodist Church website, YouTube website, and we'll be able to play it there. But it sure has been a tough road here the last couple of weekends, and with all the wet and heavy snow, it was awfully hard to move it today. I was out there for a while, and wow, that was a tough deal. But anyway, thank you, Karen, for leading, and just grateful for the opportunity to be here in worship with you by this digital message. So before I begin, let's join together in a word of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you for the precious gift of being able to come to worship even on snowy weekends. We're grateful that your grace is present no matter where we are. And we ask for your wisdom and understanding as we strive to know a little bit more about your word, your will, and your pathway for us. I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, that they would be acceptable to you, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. You know, when I think about the story of the temptation of Jesus that we just heard a few moments ago from Luke's Gospel, I think it's an interesting story because nowhere else in Scripture do we hear the story of Jesus and Satan talking together. This is really the first time that we have heard this story. Now, there are places where Jesus encounters evil, demons, and so on and so forth. But this is really the first time that gives us a precious opportunity to hear how Jesus responds directly to Satan's temptations, even when he's in a vulnerable and some might say a weakened position. To first of all realize that Jesus was tempted is a point in which it should not be lost among us. It helps us to get in touch with the humanity of Jesus, to know that he experienced temptation, that he faced it, and that he overcame it, is an inspiration for all of us as human beings, because we are human as Jesus is in that moment. And after all, who among us is in a place to say that we've never been tempted in any way, shape, or form? I think if you look back over the events of your lifetime, you might discover that you would be able to demonstrate that, yeah, you've been tempted in some way. Perhaps by sexual desire or lured by ambition, maybe, or vanity, maybe had a desire for revenge, or pursued fame or power, or had a real love for money, or held thoughts of hatred, or withheld forgiveness, or the love of self over others. I'm sure that there's a number of things that we've faced over the years as human beings. And I'm not suggesting that you gave in to any of those forms of temptation by any means whatsoever, but you were merely tempted by them. I know that I won't be able to stand before God and admit that I have never been tempted, assuming that question is asked. Of course I have been. And I believe we all have been tempted by things over the years. We're human. And to be human, part of what it means to be human is to experience temptation. So what is significant in this is our response to temptation. We may have been tempted by all of these things, but if we've resisted them, then thanks be to God, we've only done that because of God's help. And Jesus offers us a model here to resist temptation for anyone who is tempted to enter into any one thing, which might bring us further away from God. Because that really, in all honesty, is the nature of temptation. Temptation exists to separate us from God and from God's love. When Satan tempted Jesus on several fronts, each one of them had the potential to bring Jesus away from God, but Jesus never gave in to it. And when we give into a temptation, we wander off course from where God has charted our lives. We stray from the pathway of the straight and narrow highway, and we're led further and further away to a place where we become lost, further and further away from God. And in fact, when we first give in to temptation, we cross over the borderline. The model that Jesus used to resist temptation, really, it's quite simple. There are only four major components. The first is the willingness to be led by God's Spirit. The second is prayer. The third is knowing Scripture, knowing your Bible. And the fourth is having an unwavering commitment to God. These guidelines are important in overcoming the separation from God that temptation causes for any one person who claims to follow Jesus. In kind of a departure from my normal style, I want to share with you three different stories of my own lifetime. Personal disclosure 101. Times when I came across the pathway of temptation in some forms. The first story. In the late 70s, I was a drummer in a rock band. Yeah, I know. It's true story. We had a 5-member rock band. We had 3 guys in the band and 2 sisters. And the 2 sisters, they had tremendous voices, really. They complemented each other very well. We sang a lot of Fleetwood Mac, a lot of Heart, the group Heart. We sang that. And in those days, it was interesting because the 2 sisters were dating the 2 guys in the band. And maybe dating wasn't really the right word for it. And Nancy and I were still without children. We didn't have any children at this time. And we were looking somewhere for our niche in the world. And I thought that my niche at that particular time in my life was playing in this rock band. And as it turned out, I was incorrect on that assumption. We played a few gigs around the northern Minnesota area, became well known for about 5 months, and then the band decided that it was going to turn professional. In other words, we went on the road during the winter of 1978. We took our first professional booking. We played for 2 weeks at some dive on the edge of Moorhead, Minnesota. I think it was called the Red Carpet. And Nancy stayed back in Grand Rapids while I was on the road, and I remember sleeping in on Sunday morning. And I remember, as I look back on it, church was the farthest thing from my mind. In fact, at that time in my life, God seemed to be the farthest thing from my mind and my heart. In the second week we were there, a change began to sweep over the group. Suddenly, the beat that I was keeping was consistently off, according to some of the members of the band. And in my thinking, it was the same steady beat that I had always been performing for the last 5 months. But all of a sudden, it was different. What did I know? I'm only the drummer. As we continued to practice, it seemed that every single song was suddenly open to scrutiny. And the more that they pointed at me, the more flustered I got as a lowly, offbeat, self-taught drummer, as pointing to me as the source of the problem, and the more paranoid I got. I began to second-guess my ability and even my reason for being there. And so by the end of the week, the end of my second week on the road to fortune and fame, I was fired as the drummer of this rock band. The band's next stop, I was home, and they had a flashier new drummer. Technically, I had to step aside. They left me no choice. They didn't want me anymore. But that was really acceptable because I couldn't stand being away from Nancy. That was a hard 2 weeks to be away from her. And I'm almost convinced that had I stayed on the road in the rock music business, that our marriage would have been rocky as well. In fact, it may not even have survived. Too much of that lifestyle went against the grain of what I actually grew up with. It didn't serve God at all, and neither was I. And regrettably, it would take me a few years to really begin to discover that I needed to serve God. But this was really the start of that pathway. And Jesus answered from Luke 4, chapter 8, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Years later, I learned that my mom and dad were praying mightily for Nancy and I during this time frame, and that was really good. Prayer is such a powerful ally. And if you have a loved one who seems to be going down a wrong path, prayer is the first place to go, and pray diligently for them. The band went on to break up entirely within the following year. One of the sisters went on to sing in a hard rock band in a larger city. I saw her some years later. She looked haggard and worn, dark circles under her eyes. She was singing with some guy, who looked like a hood. Another of the sisters ended up singing with some guy in a band for weddings and parties and things like that. A bass player wound up managing a bookstore and a cappuccino shop. And the guitar player, I never really knew whatever happened to him. We never were that close, and we never stayed in touch. Story number two, a few years later. It was the spring of the year, and by this time of my life, I had moved on from my days on the road as a rock drummer, and I'd been working at a business in my hometown. I'd been there a number of years, and work was always busy during the spring of the year. And quite frankly, I was kind of growing weary of the long hours. I wanted to see my family. My children had been born, and they were still fairly young. And I think that Eric, my oldest, was just entering into kindergarten. My two precious little girls wanted to see me more often than I was giving them time for. So on one particular day, I was spending most of the afternoon and well into the early evening setting up a holiday display for this store that it was one of our key accounts, and it had to be set up. It was hard to keep that business happy. They were so demanding. And while it was almost done, I decided to leave and finish the display the next day, the next morning. I felt I could do that. I was the salesman for the account, so I thought that would just fine. So I went back to the office, and before I could leave the office, the owner of the company wanted to see me, which incidentally was never a good thing. The moment I went into his office, I knew something was up. He wanted to know why I hadn't finished setting up the display that day. Evidently, the walls have ears. I told him I was tired. I told him I wanted to be home with my family, that I was working on my time during that moment. And he went on this long tirade about the importance of working together as a work family and how increases in salary were based upon devotion to employees on their job and stuff like that. And I told him that my family was important to me, and that as far as I was concerned, I was being robbed of my time with them, and no amount of money could make any difference to that. We kind of scoffed at that notion, and he told me that I better get with the program and finish the display first thing the next day, which I did. And Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone," from chapter 4, verse 4. How we live our lives and what we pursue becomes very important, for we will never know how much quality time we may have with our loved ones and our families. And so at the forefront of all our lives, we must be willing to be led by God's Spirit and not after the pursuit of the almighty dollar. One last story. Mick and I had become friends at work. We had some of the same interests, and we worked in the same location. He was a relatively new Christian, fresh off a life that was more centered upon drugs and alcohol. He attended one of the more charismatic churches in the town that we lived in. And they were one of the churches that spoke in tongues, and they weren't afraid to witness to others about their faith, which was fine. Mick tried to be as strong a witness as he could on the job, at work, at play, at home. And at this time in my life, by now, I had rededicated my life to Christ and was learning more and more about His way for me. And I was Mick's supervisor at the same company from the previous story. This was years later. Evidently, I had gotten with the program. One day while at work, Mick and Tom, another co-worker, had a disagreement. Now, Tom was an interesting person. He was a self-avowed Christian who wore his faith on his sleeve as often as he could. He was one of those Christians that would go around renouncing things. Like, I remember this one time, he was fighting a cold. And he was going around work for several days rebuking the fact that he would not accept this cold, even though it was painfully obvious that he had a cold. There was one thing wrong in the relationship between these two so-called God-fearing men, between Mick and between Tom. They couldn't stand each other. Imagine that. More than one night they would argue about this and that and the other thing. One night things came to a head. And there they stood, toe-to-toe, face-to-face, nose-to-nose, ready to duke it out, because both of them were getting on each other's nerves. And I chided both of them. I took them aside. Being their immediate supervisor, I could have fired them on the spot. Probably should have. But instead, I said to them, you know what? Satan is laughing at both of you guys right now. And what kind of witnesses are you turning out to be anyway? And if you feel that you both want to continue this conflict without resolving it in a Christian fashion, then you need to take it outside. But I want to tell you something. I want each of you to know this. If you do that, if you decide to do that, then don't bother coming back in, because you won't have a job here any longer. Pretty tough supervisor. They both looked at me. They shrugged their shoulders, looked at each other, kind of limply shook hands and went about their job. And Jesus answered them, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test. The last news I heard from Mick was that he was divorced, separated from his children. I ran into some years later. He was remarried. It sounded like his life was just as crazy as it always was. And as for Tom, he had hooked up with some radical group located in New Mexico. I think it was called Revolutionary Soldiers for Jesus, something like that. He once called me about 15 years ago to see how I was doing, and it was kind of a short conversation. Robert Orban once wrote that most people want to be delivered from temptation, but some would like to keep in touch. It doesn't really work that way. The only way to resist the temptations that we presented to us is only one way, and that is the way that Jesus did it. He was willing to be led by God's Spirit. He prayed often. He knew what the Scriptures had said, and he was deeply committed to God. If we choose to climb the mount of temptation by ourselves and not follow the example that Jesus set for us by submission and commitment to God, including prayer and a good working knowledge of Scripture, we might find that we too are weak and vulnerable to resist it. And without question, we're setting ourselves up for a fall, which is exactly what Satan's plan includes, because the devil wants us to fail. He wants us to fall. He wants us to be separated from God, because he knows that he can never win the war. But he can claim some victims. So my friends, the story of the temptation of Jesus by Satan is not a fairy tale. It's not a story that we can just wave at and say, that didn't happen. Don't be tempted to do that. Instead of crossing the borderline of temptation, draw closer to God. Pray often. Study the Holy Scripture. Open your heart to God's will by serving and worshiping Him only. Pray, study, open your heart to God. That's Jesus' example in overcoming temptation. Let's make it our example today. Amen? Let's pray together. Lord, we are grateful for the word that comes to us through Luke's gospel and the example that Jesus set. May it be so in our lives as we encounter temptation, and we will, that we'll be able to overcome it by these steps that Jesus outlines for us, that we would walk this pathway and be stronger followers of your Son Jesus as a result of it. We ask all of this in His holy name, and all the children of God said, Amen.